and welcome to an episode of Tokyo Reflections with World Athletics and us, the Backstreet Boys and Girl podcast. I'm Claire.
I'm Jodie.
I'm Bayo.
And we have been asked somehow to distill our favourite moments from this summer's Olympic Games into just the very highlights. Welcome along. Okay, so next up in our Tokyo Reflections is, for me, maybe David Rudisha's 800 in London aside, the best single Olympic performance there has ever been. And I honestly don't know how this can be beaten. It's Carsten Voorholm. It is an obliteration of a world record. And it's just the most ridiculous of races. I don't even really know where to begin.
So we watched this live with our World Athletics.
Yes, you did, didn't you? Oh, the video's so good.
And literally, I mean, it's not often that we don't have anything to say, right? Never, we just like literally slacked. We're like, we just kept looking at each other. Trying to say something, but then nothing came out. Because I couldn't...
It's because it was such a ridiculously interesting and good race that you didn't look at the clock, did you?
That's what I did when I watched
it back the next morning. I turned all the notifications off on my phone and woken up the next day and watched it as though it were live. And I didn't realise the time until I saw Carsten go and then rip his speed suit open. And then you're like, no, that has to be wrong.
But that's why I didn't have anything to say because my mind couldn't catch up with what had happened.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
And I didn't know, I couldn't process what had happened. And so I couldn't think of anything coherent to say because my mind had never been in that place to have to think of something to say for that moment.
Yes.
Going in, we thought the world record might go.
Yeah.
We weren't even surprised that like two or three people beat the old world record. Mm. Not a single person on the planet thought sub 46 was a possibility.
Which actually was a time that would have seen you out, apparently, of some of the heats of the men's 400 flat at this year's Games.
It would have won the British Championships in the 400 meters.
Would it?
Yeah.
Wow. So, World Athletics, you can make the star of your sport a sprinter if it's Carsten Voorholm.
Yes.
Just to contextualise what he did, it was actually the most ridiculously stacked final as well, because the men's 400 hurdles has been one of the best events on the planet for the last couple of seasons. Samba, Benjamin Dos Santos and Voorholm. And then also a whole host of like McMaster and other amazing talents spread throughout the field. And Carsten just runs like he always runs. He gets out of the blocks like a kind of masochistic bat out of hell. And he's already gobbled up the stagger in no time. But he is running, which lane is he in again? He's got Benjamin on his inside.
Yes.
So he's running blind. So
which is how he likes it.
Benjamin starts to close the gap. And coming into the final straight, Benjamin runs an amazing exit from the bend. He really seems to find a couple of extra gears there. But then Carsten nails the final barrier. And then it's the last 70 metres where we see all of that decathlon strength.
Mm.
And all of that willingness that he always talks about to just lean into pain and suffering. It doesn't seem to bother him or scare him. He doesn't care if he goes out like a crazy man because he knows that he'll hold strong, and he does, and it's just unbelievable.
I interviewed him a couple of years back at the London Olympic Stadium, and I won't use his exact words because this is a program for children, but, but what he basically said is, it's only a few seconds of my life, you know.
Mm.
He said in other words, he said, I enjoy the pain, it feels so good, he said, because the thinking is, like, yes, it hurts, and yes, it's going to hurt, but, like, that is a tiny, tiny, tiny proportion of my entire life, and it's going to be so much worth it at the end, you know? What I love about that race is, you know, we're cheering him on all the way, and it's not like we don't like Rye Benjamin.
It's just Rye Benjamin.
It's just that over the last few years, Carsten has been the number one. He's won two worlds. The Olympics, clearly he was in the best shape of his life last year, so you would have thought he was a dead cert for the Olympics. It would have been such a shame if he'd gone and lost the Olympics this year because it got postponed. So we're all really rooting for him. The whole way round, then it comes coming up to between 8 and 9, no, 9 and 10, right between close up, and I think you're thinking, oh my God, he's actually the first time ever he's gone out too hard. Because he always looks like he's gone out too hard, doesn't he? And you think, oh no, he's actually gone out too hard. And then something happens. He adds an extra stride in, doesn't he?
He checks before 10.
But it's not quite checks, because check means that you like you run out of space and got it wrong and you put some extra strides in. He actually calculated putting an extra stride in. It was completely smooth.
Mm.
And he comes off that last hurdle and suddenly he's 2 metres up. And you're like, what point did that happen? Because you don't see it happen.
But also, the way that he runs, it's a delight for us to watch, isn't it? It's the same way, like, we love to watch Laura Muir run, because we know she's going to put everything on the track, and you're not going to get at the end and go, "Oh, I wish I wish I had, you know, made a move at a certain point." You know, she's just given it everything, and he does the same thing. He's out from the gun, and it's like, "Catch me if you can."
Yeah.
And I remember when we're watching it, because I've, you know, the video of us, we've watched a few times, as thousands of other people.
Hundreds of thousands.
We're like this. There's this weird thing where we're like, we lean to the side.
Yes,
like, yeah. We're going to catch something, like we're going to see it properly.
There's a moment, I think it is when he puts the extra stride, and we both go, ooh.
We see it, it's like, we see it happening. What's so great about him is that not only did he do that, but he's dragged the event on.
Yeah.
Because in the last few years, with Samba, with Rye Benjamin, with McMaster, they've all started making 45.5 ordinary.
Now there
46.
Was...
47.5 ordinary. There was a time for the few years before that, from like sort of 9, 10, 11 onwards, where people were running 48. I think Di Green won the Worlds in like in 48 something. And the event had just kind of stagnated a bit, you know? And then suddenly, it only takes like two people, take some competition, which brings the others on, and then suddenly you've got 3, 4, 5 people all competing, and they're pushing each other, making you run that fast. You're not going to be able to, in the next few years, get into a final if you don't go under 48. Hey, are you really?
No. Like you said, we really like Rye Benjamin and Dos Santos too. Your heart goes out to them, because imagine running that fast.
Was it 46.17?
Something ridiculous, and still not winning the race. In any other championship throughout history, that would have been the Carsten performance. That would have been the one that we're all sat on a sofa talking about.
You say to any of them, "I'm going to give you this time in the Olympic final. Will you take it?" I can't imagine anyone said no.
And I think Carsten as well, we've seen this coming. And so it felt, like you said, a really lovely culmination of years of being a fantastic personality, being articulate and a little bit kooky with his slapping and his screaming on the start line and the Viking horns, and him and his relationship with Coach Leaf. Carsten is such a phenomenon within the sport, but he's also got the performances to back it up. And it felt wonderful to see that come to fruition on the stage, the Olympics.
Also the fact that he takes the time, like you request him on social media, would you do an interview? Yes. And he takes the time to spend an hour talking to you. And it's that kind of thing, that kind of, not common touch, but the very fact that he's willing to interact with people that love the sport and share, like, the interview with you, but then we can share it with all the people, our listeners, that makes people love him even more, because he's so approachable. But this is, for me, such an opportunity for, you know, the truth is, after Usain Bolt retired, athletics was a bit in the wilderness in that no one quite knew what to do. We'd relied on him for 10 years, he disappears, and suddenly it's like, oh, there are so many marketable people around at the moment. There are so many great personalities. There are so many people that, not just, you know, I was going to say the kids, but it is about bringing new people to the sport, isn't it? There's so many people that they can look up to, they can have an interest in, who are doing these amazing performances. They've got something to back it up as well. It's just a really, really great moment and a great opportunity for athletics as a sport to promote itself.
And how perfect that next year there are something like 21 major championships. So there are going to be loads of opportunities for these athletes to shine, and also for less experienced younger athletes to come through and blood themselves on the big stage. Major championships next year. If you're Carsten Vorholm, he loves to compete. Do you reckon we'll see him at all of them?
Oh, wow. So because we've got the World Indoors. He could do the 400. He could win the 400 at the World Indoors. Mm-hmm. We've got the World Championships and we've got the European Championships. I would be interested whether he does something a little bit different.
Yeah.
Like he does the 400 indoor, maybe tries the 400 at the Europeans.
What would Norway's team be like for that? Not so great.
No, but like to try the 400 or to try... Yeah. I mean,
high hurdles.
I mean, he's the kind of athlete as well who will go, let's have a go.
Yeah.
Because the World Championships is relatively early, isn't it? And then we've got the European Championships are afterwards in August, which means that it opens it up. You know, if you've got your World Championship medal, what do you do
for
the rest of the season?
But also, he would probably be the favourite for the 400 metres at the Europeans.
But think, it's not just that.
Yeah.
We've got the Diamond League throughout the rest of the season. So if the World Championships is done by July, that opens up a whole world of possibilities for the next 2 months, doesn't it?
The World Championships, though, Eugene next year, so it's in America, the first ever World Championships in America. You know the Americans are brunging it. Rye Benjamin is not going to want to lose in his home country. And, like, he's only this far away, so it's not like it's... Obviously, Carsten is the favourite. He's got to be the favourite. But he's not an over... Yes, he wins. He does win the majors. But he's not an... Like, he's not an overwhelming favourite.
It's not like Rojas, is it?
No. Like, so there's definitely an opportunity for Rye Benjamin to win. and for DeSantos to win, who's improved more than anybody.
Yes.
Mm. You never know if Samba's going to be back in the form that he was in.
Kind of Masters feel like he's fulfilled his potential, does he?
No, exactly. So, like, it's not going to be easy. And I don't think they're going to be running 45 seconds again.
No, I agree.
Was a moment. The same way that when Kevin Young set the world record, the previous world record, back in 92 or 93. It was at the Olympics or the World Championships in 92 or 93. And then you think, oh, we've broken 47 seconds. People are going to be running 46. Didn't happen for 20, nearly 30 years. So I think that's a moment that we're not going to see repeated very soon.
It was, without a shadow of a doubt, the jaw on the floor moment of the Games, right? So you had the heartwarming moment of the high jump. We had a couple of other absolute sparklers and amazing performances. But in terms of sheer disbelief, I'm still not over
it. No, I still don't believe it.
Because that 45 doesn't look right,
no,
does it? So, but do you know what I mean? When you sit in front of a four hurdles at 45, it's still not computing. It's not going to compute for a long time.
In theory, it's 2 seconds, roughly, you take off a 400-metre hurdles time for your flat time. So he's running 43-something. Mm. Flat, but he doesn't train for that. Like, what's so good about Carson as a 400 meter hurdler is his attitude and his hurdling techniques. He's so smooth. So if he put some speed work in, God, he'd be breathless.
Well, yes, you'd think, but I don't think he does. I think he is technically so strong.
Yeah.
I think he makes way for the hurdles that like no one else does. He attacks the hurdles like no one else does. So I don't think his differential is 2 seconds, but he's still one of the best 400-meter runners in Europe, and I'd love to see him win that title.
And I want to see him, as he said in the interview, he reckons he could have Jakob Ingebrigtsen over 600 metres.
Oh!
Let's make it happen.
They have that... they're both Norwegian, but they have that championship in...
The Slit Games?
No, they have a Norway versus Sweden thing, don't they?
Every year.
So yeah. It'd be really cool to throw some things like that in.
Oh, it'd be great. Just the more Carsten, the better, basically. Thanks very much for watching this episode of Tokyo Reflections with us, the Backstreet Boys and Girl podcast. I've been Claire.
I'm Jody.
I'm Bayo.
If you'd like to listen to the podcast, you can find us on Twitter under the Backstreet Boys, on Instagram, and we have lots of guests, we have lots of chat, we have lots of irreverence, and we get lots of facts wrong.
So thanks for tuning in, and we will see you all in Eugene.